Welcome back, everybody, to Whiteboard Finance. As you know, my name is Marco Zladek, and you're in for a treat today. I actually have a real estate investor by the name of Luke Chung, who I'm interviewing today. Luke Chung is a real estate investor from Winston-Salem, North Carolina, who is documenting his journey as a multifamily real estate investor, work-from-home dad, and vlogger. A year ago, he had a promising career, zero properties, and no kids. Now he has no boss, 54 apartment units, and a son. I'd like to welcome Luke Chung to the channel. How's it going, Luke?
Hey, pretty good, Marco. Man, that's a pretty good intro. That's crazy.
Yeah, who wrote that? Did I come up with that myself?
Thanks for having me, Marco.
Of course. And just so you guys know, Luke and I are joking around. I literally took that verbatim from his Instagram profile and from his YouTube channel. So yeah, Luke, tell us a little bit about yourself and why you ultimately got into real estate investing in the first place.
Sure. So it's kind of funny because like a year ago, I was sitting in an office and I was in corporate America climbing the corporate ladder. And, you know, I always had this desire to do something kind of entrepreneurial or for myself because I kind of grew up in that environment. My father was an entrepreneur and I always realized I wanted to do that, but I never had like a good reason to do it. Like, you know, I felt like I always needed an excuse to do it. And I've been very lucky with my career where each position that I had, I got more and more responsibility and I just kept learning and learning more. So I really didn't have a reason to leave until about a year ago where I started feeling like, okay, I'm not learning as much anymore. And then when my son was born last year, that was the trigger because he came out premature. He had a lot of medical issues. I mean, we almost lost him, you know, once, and it was kind of scary. And then once that happened, you know, my wife and I, we were like, you know, we thought we could leave him with someone, but then we felt like, well, one of us should really watch after him. And because, you know, my wife, she loved her job, and I felt like I was getting a little capped in my position. And so that's where I said, okay, here's the excuse. Let me try working from home, taking care of Max, but doing something sort of entrepreneurial, see if I can build my own business empire, you know, and see what happens. And so it's been a fantastic journey ever since. I mean, I've just been having the greatest time, you know, building a business and looking forward to what happens next.
That's awesome. So tell us how you ultimately got out of the quote unquote rat race. How does that first deal break down?
Yeah. So, you know, there obviously when you get out and you want to do something entrepreneurial, there's lots of things that you can do, right? I mean, there's just the whole gamut of things. And, you know, I was very heavily invested. I think most of it was like in my 401k and I had lots of stocks that I was kind of accumulating over time. But then when you get out and when you kind of, I would say not retire, but you don't have any income anymore, then you're looking for assets that can produce like consistent income on a regular basis. And so my two options were small business or real estate. Small business, you know, I got close, but had a hard time finding something. So I ended up doing real estate. And so I was really looking at single family homes. I was looking at, you know, how I can buy a single family home. And I didn't want to do the flipping because I didn't want a job. I just wanted to do a buy and hold. So, you know, I did the math and it's crazy because like, you know, I did the math on one house and I felt like, well, if I do this one house, I might get like, you know, maybe around $1,000 a year, you know, in income. And I was like, well, how many houses would I have to buy in order to like support, you know, what I was making before? And it was like, you know, hundreds of houses. And I couldn't close on hundreds of houses in a year. And that's what got me into multifamily. So my first purchase was actually a 54 unit apartment complex. And it's crazy because I had no experience in real estate. You know, it was my first deal ever. And I bought this like 54 unit apartment complex for, you know, call it $4 million. And, you know, I basically got on the map here in the real estate community in this area. And so now I'm getting all these like deals, pitched to me, but you know, my goal this year is hopefully to buy 100 units, or more. So
that's great. That's great. Yeah, thanks for sharing that. So ultimately, the shakeout between single family and multifamily, A, it just seems like it would have taken forever and it would have been pretty improbable for you to reach your goals going the single family route, right?
Yeah. I think it just depends for, you know, it just depends on the situation of the person. Obviously, like if you got to start somewhere, and I'm not saying that there's bad deals in single family. You can find just as good of deals in single family, but it just depends on the velocity and the volume. Like how fast do you want to get quickly, or, you know, like how much resources do you have at your disposal? You know, I think in terms of return, you can get, you know, 20% return either way, but it's kind of like, you know, 20% of a smaller asset versus a larger asset. And so just depending on where they are. And I just, you know, had a little bit more resources because I'm starting the game late. I'm like in my 40s, you know, and I'm starting. And I know a lot of people here on YouTube are kind of younger. And so starting the game late, but the good thing is I'm able to have resources that I've accumulated over time. Plus my experiences with business and everything allow me to kind of accelerate faster. So yeah, it's, you know, give or take.
Yeah, that makes sense. So how did you come about that deal, the $4 million property that you're talking about?
Yeah, so if you want to get into real estate, especially multifamily, it is a very closed community in most markets. So in like, if you're dealing with single family homes, sure, you can just get a broker anywhere, you know, for residential and, you know, find someone that, you know, has a little bit of investment experience and you're good to go. In the multifamily world, real estate brokers are a little bit more picky and they have their own sort of network of investors. And so if you're new and you're trying to break into that network, it's very difficult. And so I spent maybe 6 or 7 months just networking with brokers, showing that I am a serious buyer, that I know what I'm doing, even though I had no experience, you know, showing them that I know what I'm doing, getting them comfortable with me. And then they start feeding you their deals, not the deals that they publish, you know, on, you know, it's not an MLS, but something similar to that, where, you know, everybody can see that listing, but they're called pocket listings, which are listings that, you know, the brokers only give to a select few, to their best, you know, investors. And I started getting those pocket listings, and that is what got me to this property.
That's
my broker actually didn't have the property. He used me as a buyer. That's you know, so he was trying to get that listing, but he actually used me saying that, hey, I have this buyer that's really interested in your property. If you give me the listing. And so it was kind of win-win for both of us. I got a really great deal on a property and he got the listing. So he got the commission. So it worked out well.
That's great. So ultimately, just to summarize for the audience, if you guys have never closed on a bigger property, to Luke's point, it's kind of like a closed circle or almost like a closed community, right? You feel like it's like the Illuminati of multifamily.
Exactly.
Ultimately, these brokers, and I can speak from experience, I worked I was actually a landlord rep. I did a lot of office leases. We worked in senior living. I worked for a developer, essentially. But ultimately, these brokers, they're going to give these deals to their closers, right? They know people who are willing and able to close on these deals. That's who they want to work with. They don't want to work with the tire kickers, right?
That's right. That's right. And that's why if anyone wants to get into like multifamily, you got to spend a lot of time relationship building. And I think that's one of the things that a lot of people don't, I mean, they think they can just get the numbers. And if you have the capital, you're in. It's not like that in this world. You really have to be buddy-buddy with a lot of the brokers and earn their respect.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll say, I speak from experience, there's a lot of people that could have, you know, ready and able to close, they're first, they have the highest price, but a lot of these landlords or even the brokers, they'll go with the second or third in line just because they have a better reputation. They're known for not retrading these deals. And for my audience that may not know what retrading means, it's when you go into a property, you offer X and you come back with an offer of Y at a much lower price. You're kind of in there just to get the property under contract. You know, you do your due diligence, you come back at a significantly lower price. That's called retrading a deal. So tell us about some value add or your strategy for the property that you acquired? Did you just acquire this as a stabilized asset? Was there some opportunities to add value? Tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah, sure. So first of all, when I bought this property, I would say that I would break the value into two pieces. The first piece was how I financed the property. So you can go to a traditional bank and, you know, get the property financed, and typically you would have to put like a 20% down payment, you know, on the property to get it. Well, I actually did not go through a bank. I got seller financing. So I only had to put down 10% of the 10% down of the purchase price for the down payment. And that's awesome. The terms that I got were basically very on par with a Fannie Mae multifamily loan, which is one of the lowest rates possible, and it's non-recourse, so it can't come back to me personally. The collateral is just the property itself. So it's a great loan, and so that allowed me to pay a little bit more for the property. But once I got the property, you know, there's just so many things where I could increase the income. And when you increase the income in real estate, you increase the valuation when you sell. And so one of the things that the seller was doing to the property was that he was giving utilities for free to the tenants, where all the other properties in the area were charging for utilities.
Free car washes, baby.
Exactly. I mean, people were probably, you know, turning their faucets on, you know, the heat's up all, you know, they jack the heat up really high, AC, everything. I mean, he was paying for water, gas, electricity, cable, internet, I mean, all of it. And so, I mean, it is significant value, because when you look at a property, utilities is like one of the major cost categories in a property. And so when you bill that back to the tenants, it really increases your income. So there was that. The other thing was, the seller was he's basically a contractor. And so they like building new buildings. They don't like managing properties. And so there was a lot of mismanagement going on. So with my professional property manager in there, they're finding all these different ways to decrease costs, as well as getting better tenants in. And so there's just a lot of opportunities to increase that income. And
that's awesome.
Yeah.
So let's talk about, in a very simplified version, because this isn't primarily a real estate audience, but let's talk about capitalization. So this is a 54-unit property. Let's just say, for super easy numbers, you're saving, let's call it $100 per unit, right? And these expenses, yeah, probably a little bit more than that, but for easy numbers, so 54 times 100, that's right around $5,400, okay, down to your bottom line. At a 10% capitalization rate, you know, you guys can do the math. You want to explain a little bit how that can add value to the audience?
Yeah, yeah. So like, for example, like my apartment complex, like I calculated that for every dollar that I save in terms of expense, when I sell it, it's going to generate me $14 of return. So it's a 14 times multiple on whatever. I mean, just very simply. So cap rate is typically like 6% for multifamily in my market where it is. So if you take the inverse of 6%, 1 divided by 0.6, you get like 14, close to 14. So every dollar that I save, so to Marco's point, if you save, you know, $100, it ends up being, what is that, 14,000? Is that right?
Yeah.
1,000. Yeah. $14,000 of additional value. So that's what I'm, you know, that's where the value of multifamily is. You can't do that with a single family house, because the thing with single family houses are, they're valued not on income. Most single family houses are valued based on the comps in the area, the market comps. So even if you were to get high rent, it might not necessarily translate into the value of the house when you sell it, because the people who are buying that house might not necessarily be investors. They're probably people who want to live in that house, and they're looking at comps to value that. Where in multifamily, it's a little bit more cold-blooded, where it's all about numbers. And so if you're able to add income, I mean, when you sell it, it's a huge payoff. Like,
that's right.
Right now, Marco, like, I don't even know if I want to buy another property. I'd rather invest my money on increasing income at my current property, because, you know, 14 times your money is like a huge bang for the buck. And so, absolutely, like, when you compare it, you know, it's hard to compare that.
So everyone knows that real estate is a team sport, right? You can't do everything yourself. You mentioned your property manager. Who else is on your team? Who else helped you close this deal?
Yeah, so in order to close a real estate deal, I think the property manager is, I would say, the most important player in that arena. So you need a good property manager, you need a good mortgage broker or someone sort of on the finance side, and you need a good attorney. Those three are the sort of the main players that you need to close a deal. Now, if you're looking for a deal, I would say that you don't have to find those people right away. Because when you find a deal, usually the broker that you're working with will give you recommendations of who the top people are in order to close the deal. Because if you just try to find your own, professional, you might end up being, that broker, you might end up finding that they're not able to help you close that deal, where the broker who has closed many deals knows exactly, you know, which professional can help you close that deal the best. And so a lot of people are, you know, always think, well, I need to set up my LLC first. I need to get, you know, all these team members in place. The first thing that you have to do is just really analyze the property. Does that property make sense? Do you have enough funds to close? And then once you figure that out, the broker will set up all the other relationships for you.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think it's super important to know that, you know, analysis by paralysis affects so many people, especially because they think, like you mentioned, you have to have the LLC set up, you have to know these people, you have to know that people. Yeah. I think for beginners especially, just go on loopnet.com, okay? Pick a number of properties every week, analyze them, pretend as if you're pretending to invest in these deals. Get comfortable with the numbers, and then if something comes across the table to where, hey, this just genuinely is a good investment, that's when you can start bringing in the team members, because a good deal will always attract the capital. It'll always attract the professionals that are needed to close that deal. That's my personal opinion.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, Marco. And, you know, to your point, I mean, when I first started this thing, it took me 11 months to close that first deal, and wow. I probably analyzed about 100 deals. You know, and I didn't buy all 100 deals, but you imagine analyzing that many deals. I mean, it really is a numbers game. And if you're really serious, I mean, that level of analysis weeds out a lot of people. But I mean, 100 deals I looked at, and maybe I put offers on 5 of them. And then I went to contract on 3 of them. And in due diligence, 2 of them fell out, and I ended up with 1. So I know that that's sort of my funnel. And this year, when I'm looking for that 100 unit property, it's probably going to be similar. I'm nowhere near 100 deals that I've analyzed yet on the 100 deal property this year. But hopefully when I get there, I'll be able to close on at least one.
We'll great. See. So now that you went with 50 plus units on your first deal, do you regret anything? Are you happy? Are you looking for bigger properties, smaller properties? Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, you know, I don't really regret anything. I think, you know, because when I first looked, Marco, I was really looking at like 20 units, 25 units as my first deal. The only reason I did this 54 unit deal was because I was able to negotiate seller financing. So instead of 20% down, I had to put 10% down. So it was almost like I was buying, you know, like a $2 million property, but I got it for $4 million just because I had to put less money down. And so, you know, I don't regret anything. I feel like, you know, 54 units is just the right size for me to have like a part-time property manager in there. If you go less than 54 units, you know, if I had done the 20 unit deal, I feel like, it would have been too small for a property manager to really be interested in managing that even part-time. Mm-hmm. And so, there is kind of a no man's land in terms of units, you got to make sure that you have enough units where a property manager would be kind of interested in. But yeah, I didn't have enough money to do a bigger deal. So no regrets. No regrets.
That's great. Yeah. So how's your transition been from, corporate, white collar guy all the way to stay at home dad?
It's challenging. I think the stay at home dad part is probably the hardest job I've ever had in my life.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. It is. I mean, it's tough because, I think it's the mental aspect of it because, you're with your baby, you're with your kid, and they obviously can't even speak at this point, and I'm used to communicating with very intelligent people on a day-to-day basis. And so, that part of it is really tough. But then once I started getting into real estate and I had to make phone calls and stuff like that, then that kind of world came back up. But yeah, I am, a lot of my friends tell me this, even my former bosses all tell me this, is like, man, you got something different in your voice. It's like you have this new passion, online.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So it's definitely a different attitude.
That's awesome. So everything seems to be going well with the property, knock on wood. How long have you owned it now, if you don't mind me asking?
Yeah, so we bought it in December 1st. And so,
Wow, close it in December. Not easy. Yeah. Not easy to do.
Yeah, we bought in December 1st. And, that might be my one regret, is buying it in December. Because, there is this thing called the December effect in real estate where I found this out the hard way, but people end up, buying gifts and toys and Christmas presents and whatever, and they decide to not pay rent that month. And then so we have this whole collection process going on from that effect. But the good thing was that I was so conservative in my model. We're still going to be able to hit our numbers this year. But right. Had I known that, I might have discounted a little bit more or waited to close a little bit later.
Yeah.
But the good thing was there's tax benefits that happened for closing right last year. And that's come back to help a lot. So
good. So you mentioned earlier in this podcast or vlog or whatever you want to call this interview, that your goal is to acquire, 100 plus more units.
Yeah.
Are you trying to do that under one complex? Or are you trying to do that with a collection of, a couple of 20s, 30s, 40s?
Yeah. Good question.
What's your strategy?
Yeah. So I want to do it with one complex. The more that I'm in this, I realize that there's benefits of having one complex. If you compare my 54 unit, if I had 54 houses that were kind of in this area, it'd still be a nightmare to manage because I would have to drive to all the different houses, or my property manager would.
Yeah.
And, just having it all in one location makes a whole lot of sense, especially from the expense side, because we get so many bulk discounts on the expense side with our suppliers. And so if I were to do another one, I would want it to be all in one unit. I wouldn't want one complex. I wouldn't want to have, a whole bunch of 20s around, because then it's getting back to kind of like the single family house mentality, where you have all these properties that you have to manage.
Exactly. And that makes sense. So the easiest analogy is that, if you have one complex, let's assume that it's one building. Sometimes it's not, but one roof, one lawn, one boiler, instead of
replacing
54 single family roofs, 54 driveways, 54 lawns. So there's a lot of economies of scale to that.
That's right. And the most important one is having on-site presence. It's hard to do that with 20s, but if you have like with 54, you could maybe justify part-time. So my property has someone there either in the mornings every day or in the afternoons every day. But if I had 100 unit, I can afford to pay someone to be there all day, like a full shift. And so that's the key, because a lot of these apartment complexes without on-site management, they tend to get wild. So
that's a good way to put it.
Yeah.
So it seems like everything's going good for you now, except for that December effect. Have you had any war stories yet in your short investing, real estate investing career?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, nothing ever goes to plan, right? So you know, with that December effect, we had sort of late tenants, and it's funny because, like, you know, some of those tenants haven't paid, and so we had to go through some eviction process. And that was probably one of the hardest things for me, was to evict like tenants, because I don't even think that they realize what happens in an eviction. But, you know, typically, you know, it goes on your credit. And then when they ask for references in your next place, you know, they're going to ask, well, where did you live? And, you know, they're not going to get a good reference. So it's really hard to find a place to live. I mean, you can use your relatives' names or whatever to get the apartment, but at some point, it's just really hard to do that. And I'm glad I'm not doing the evictions. My property manager's taking care of that. But that was kind of one of the hardest things, especially like in December, January, you know, the winter time when it's kind of cold, just right after Christmas. It just felt like I had some, I guess, moral struggles with the whole thing. Yeah. But
it's a lease. It goes both ways, you know. Yeah. It goes both ways. So as a landlord, you know, you and I have obligations to the tenants, but vice versa, you know. So yeah. So let's define cold. I'm from Northeast Ohio. You're from North Carolina. So I don't know if we're talking about the same kind of cold here.
It's not quite like Ohio. No, it's not quite like Ohio. But to give you some reference, it did snow yesterday.
Okay.
In North Carolina, which was kind of weird. I was like, what? Is it really snowing at the end of March?
Late March. Yeah, that's insane.
Yeah.
Okay. So we're coming up here on about half an hour, I'd say. Give or take a few minutes. I'm going to try and wrap this up and get into some closing questions. So one of the questions that I like to ask is, what is your favorite business book?
Ooh, favorite business book. Well, I would say, like, this is going to be kind of a, oh my gosh, this is going to be a very complex one. I don't know if I would recommend your readers to read this book, because I'm kind of a nerd. But there's this book called Valuation, and it was written by like the McKinsey Group. That is the best book that I've ever read on like finance. And when I tell you, like, you can value any asset, that book is like key. It's called Valuations. Yeah. And so, like, especially for your audience, if there are people that are very sophisticated with stocks and want to value that company, that Valuations book is what I would recommend reading if you really want to know how, like, investment bank analysts put a price on, like, a stock or a company. And I use it for real estate, and so it's like overkill for the real estate industry, but the numbers were good. I mean,
that's awesome. Yeah, I need to check that out. Usually a typical response is, you know, rich dad, poor dad, or something along those lines. I'm glad I got an answer outside of the box. That's great. I'll definitely look into that. So I'm stealing this question from another podcaster who I respect and admire very much. So what business or life advice would you give your 20-year-old self, knowing what you know now?
Yeah, I would say that if I were to give advice, I would say don't chase the money. Chase the knowledge. And what I mean by that is, you know, when I was in my 20s, you know, I graduated from, you know, pretty good school, and, you know, had good degrees and everything. And I saw all my friends trying to go into kind of like the name brand companies, you know, you know, where it's going to look good on their resume, even though, you know, you might be stuck in a position where you don't really learn that much. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I see a lot of people kind of doing what's trendy. And I would say, like, don't focus on the money. Focus on what you're going to learn and get out of it. Because if you learn it right, the money will follow later on. And it's so true in my life. And that's what I would give, you know, even advice to my son when he turns 20.
That's great. No, that's excellent advice. And that's kind of the path that I went down. So I had the privilege of graduating in one of the biggest recessions in this country's history. I graduated with a finance degree in December of 2010. So long story short, no one was really hiring. So I said, you know, what am I going to freaking do, man? I can't get a job. So I actually ended up selling cars. So with sales experience, that was actually one of the biggest blessings in disguise, man.
That's a great experience.
You can sell anything, man.
Exactly.
Yeah, it really taught me how to read people. You know, there's a lot of phrases that people say, like, you know, all buyers are liars. And if their lips are moving, they're lying, you know, stuff like that. That's not the case with most people. But it really helps you read people. And from that point, I went to a startup company to where I learned about, you know, mergers and acquisitions, you know, venture capital. Yep. Got real connected pretty well here in the Cleveland community with, you know, investors and things like that. And then also from there, went to a real estate development company, which I would have never heard of or known of if it wasn't for the startup company that I worked for previously. So you're absolutely right. I think you hit the nail on the head. People, they go for these, you know, Fortune 500, Fortune 100 companies, these, you know, name brand companies, if you will, but they don't realize that they may get stuck in a corner, you know, not really understanding the whole picture of how that business operates. So, you know, I could walk into the principal of the company's office, knock on their door and, you know, give them an idea or let them know what's on my mind or, you know, things along those lines, to where you're almost working in these silos in these bigger companies. So my point to this ramble is that if you're younger, don't always go for, you know, the shiny object or, you know, chase the squirrel. You know, you got to go for opportunities to where you're going to be hands-on and where you're going to learn the most. So I completely agree with you on that, Luke.
Yeah, I mean, just kind of hearing your background, Marco, I know you're going to be successful in whatever you do, because that, I mean, that kind of learning experience that you had, I mean, you've been exposed to all these different fields. So you're not pigeonholed to like one area. The reason why a lot of people in their careers feel like they're pigeonholed is because they only know that. And there's no other choice to go out and do something different. So, well said. Very well said.
Yeah, thank you. So where can people get a hold of you or learn more about you? You have a great YouTube channel with a ton of value. And I should probably introduce that a little bit earlier in this interview, because guys, I watch a lot of Luke's videos. He is absolutely crushing it with value in all his videos.
Yeah, I would say that's probably the best way to follow me. I basically document my entire life after I quit my job. And so I don't do a lot of teaching. I do some teaching, some tutorials, but really I'm just trying to document the process of, you know, how I'm building my business. And so, yeah, my YouTube channel is Luke Chung. So you could just do a search on YouTube, Luke Chung, and I'll pop up. And that's the best way to get a hold of me.
Great. Yeah, I'll leave a link in the description below for everyone directly to your YouTube channel. I'm telling you guys, a ton of value, because it almost shows him blossoming or evolving as a real estate investor. And his videos are great, you guys. So anything else you want to wrap the interview up with, Luke? Thanks for coming on. I really appreciate it.
No, I appreciate the time, Marco. Let's do this again and, you know, let's work together.
Of course. Yeah. If you need any boots on the ground in Cleveland, let me know.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
It was a pleasure. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Marco.